Hey, Sue Smithers was Australia's very first supermodel. She called the rich and the famous her mates, and boy, does she have some extraordinary tales to tell. Our very own Craig Bennett caught up with her.
Stunning Sue Smithers was Australia's first supermodel. She graced the covers of esteemed magazines such as French and Italian Vogue. She was, without doubt, one of the world's most in-demand models in the 70s and the 80s.
A drink that is so refreshing, it makes you feel remarkably cool.
To party, another glass of iced tea, sleep. And a saucer of milk for the cat.
Noah was one of the first models to go off by themselves overseas with no support, no family. We didn't have internet. We didn't even have emails. So you were gone, you were gone. It was like $100 to call home for 5 minutes. It was incredible, you know. I think to be successful is so mad that you just really, the people who make it, is they have to live in the present moment. That's it. You have to live in the present moment. I remember going back to London on a plane with Jerry Hall. We have flatmates in Paris, and we fly back to London, and we're in a cab going past Knightsbridge and Harrods, and I was like, oh, and there's all of these models who are me from this English Vogue shoot. And she said, oh, look, hon. And I was like, oh, my God, I just want to do a happy dance and go, woo-woo. But I wanted to be cool. I was going, oh, wow, you know. I was like, oh, my God. You know, things like that that are like, how could that happen?
How did you get to flat with Jerry Hall and Grace Jones? They must have been crazy times.
Yeah. Well, there's this guy, Dick Balerian, who was so cool. And I'm still in touch with him today. He was an advertising executive. He had a dream to be a fashion photographer. He had a lot of money. He got this fabulous apartment in Rue de Rennes in Paris, near the Boulevard Saint-Germain, you know, Brasserie Deep and De Magot, all that place. Some Australian girls were staying there, and I needed a place to stay. They said, go and stay with, I think there's a room available. So I did, and there it was. And Jerry was staying there, and Grace. And, you know, I was slightly jealous of those girls because they're a bit older than me, but they were also a lot more confident, because those American girls are like, hey, you know, they really speak their mind. And especially, I think Australian women are more confident now, but back then we were told to be little ladies and behave ourselves. There was a lot of famous models living there. Yeah, I made a lot of my best friends there to this day, like Yolande from Belgium. She was so fabulous and so gorgeous and so sexy. And she would always come out in the morning in a kimono smoking. And she said, darling, they used to go out every night at midnight, all dressed up to the nines. And I just always wanted to work. I'd go to bed at 10. They go, Suzanne, darling, you must come out tonight. I'm like, no, thank you. I just thought it was boring. I didn't want to go out with a bunch of, you know. And I would go to bed early so I, you know, look good. And she'd come out in the morning and she said, darling, we had the most fabulous time. You really should have come. You must come tonight, Suzanne. I'm like, yeah, yeah. I didn't think I was. I didn't want to hang out with her.
So, Sue, true confessions, who did the washing up?
Oh, we didn't do washing up. I was trying to remember what we did eat. I can't remember.
Did you actually eat anything? I mean, did models eat things back then?
I mean, we didn't cook. No way. I think we went out to dinner. Yes, I went to lunch and I'd go. I remember I used to go to my agents and I'd stop. I'd dress myself up and I'd go out and I'd go and it's time for lunch and I'd have the salad niçoise. That's it. And maybe dinner later, but didn't really eat. Wasn't a thing.
Sue starred in movies such as Sweet Dreamers and she sizzled on the small screen in hit TV dramas like The Restless Years.
All this double-dealing and double-crossing, you couldn't live without it, could you? Well, whatever you think, I'm not made like that.
And if modelling and acting weren't enough, Sue has a voice too. Now, you became great friends with the Beatles guitar god George Harrison. How did you two meet?
Aw, Georgie Porgy, Puddin' and Pie, and kissed the girls and made them cry.
Did he make you cry?
No.
So how did you meet?
Oh, well, you know, my boyfriend was Eric Idle, and we were living in St. John's Wood in this fabulous house, and he became friends with George. I came back and forward from London and, you know, Paris, and then he's like, darling, we've got to go out and see George. He can't wait to meet you. And I'm like, George Harrison. And I go, and I'm like, okay, great. So he goes, okay, we're going out this weekend. So we drive out to Henley. I mean, can you imagine this? Like, I'm 19 and George Harrison can't wait to meet me. It was pretty out there. And, you know, so we got out there and he's like, Susie, how are you? Let me show you around, darling. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, what a way to arrive at George Harrison. So I was like, crazy. So, you know, show me around, and it was like a palace and had a pirate's flag. And, you know, he'd say, come and I'll show you this. Stand against the wall. It was like fake Versailles, and goes, watch. And he leaned against it and turn around like in those movies. And we're in a different room. And he had like, you know, come and I'll show you the cave. So go down and you get in the cave like a river cave, and you go in the house in the river cave, and there's all these little glow worms and diamonds, and you come out on the lake. It was crazy. We had such fun. And he said, you know, darling, it was built by a loony in the 30s. We're all loonies, girl.
And this is Sue in George Harrison's music video for True Love.
Dubbed the Quiet Beatle, was that what he was really like?
No, I think George is really strong. He doesn't have to say a lot, you know what I mean? And I remember asking him, what's your favourite Beatles song? And he goes, do you want me to play it for you, girl? And I said, yeah. So he played me, Her Majesty's a pretty nice girl, but she doesn't have a lot to say.
Her Majesty's a pretty nice girl, but she changes from day to day. I want to tell her that I love her a lot, but I gotta get a belly full.
Ooh, now in part two of this fascinating chat, Sue Smithers will reveal how far her relationship with Beatle George Harrison went. Plus, her raunchy romance with Mick Jagger. Will be serving up all of the juicy details shortly. Well, Sue Smithers was Australia's very first supermodel. In part one of our exclusive interview earlier in the show, we heard how she graced covers of international fashion magazines like Vogue and Elle. She also spoke about how she fell in love with George Harrison, one of the Beatles. And now we're going to hear about a family breakup that broke her heart. Here's more of Craig Bennett's interview with Sue Smithers.
Faster than a bullet from a gun.
So is it right you could have become Mrs. George Harrison?
Well, that's a little bit naughty, isn't it? Well, he really did fancy me, and he was very naughty. He kept, you know, because Eric was friends and we were doing all these videos, and he'd sneak kisses, grab me and kiss me, and I'd be like, oh, I was so shocked, oh my God, you know. I'm, you know, pretty straight. I was like, oh my God, oh my God. Well, who knows, but, you know, I'm not.
You're blushing now.
Oh, no.
I can see it. You are.
Anyway, okay, he's gorgeous, you could have become Mrs. him, and he loved me, and that's it.
She loved you, yeah, yeah, yeah. She loved you, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did you kick around with John, Paul, Ringo, the other Beatles?
Spent a bit of time with Ringo. Paul, we were always having dinner with Paul at Elton John's place, but Paul and George were always fighting, so it always got cancelled. And then John, whoa. Well, you know, spent a month in New York when they first went. I went over for the weekend, ended up staying a month. Monty Python were Flying Circus was performing in New York, and for the first time, and they were like, whoa, superstars. That was before paparazzi, but they had paparazzi. And so every night, I was such a baby, and I just really couldn't stay up late. And, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, they'd wake me up and say, come on, we're going over to John's. He can't wait to meet you, darling. I'm like, I can't do it. I just can't. You know, Harry Nilsson, John.
How old
Lennon.
Were you, Sue?
I was 19. So, and they always say, Susie's a baby. You got to take care of Susie. You know what I mean? Take care of her.
Mick Jagger is another world-famous rock star you got tangled up with. How did that happen?
He knew Eric again, and one day Eric said to me, Mick's going to come and stay for a week. He was divorcing Bianca Jagger at the time, so it was a long time ago, yeah? And I went, whoa, okay, whatever. I came home one day and there was, like, music or something upstairs. I thought, who's home? Because Eric wasn't there, you know. So I went upstairs and there was this girl with long brown hair sitting kind of like, you know, on the... with her back to me in my kangaroo sweater, my Jenny Key kangaroo sweater, and I was eating an apple, and I said, excuse me, they're watching television. And I turned around, said, yeah, what? And it was Mick Jagger, and I was like, oh, hi, you know. So that's how I met him.
And he was wearing your sweater?
He was in my sweater, and he never gave it back. And he used to always call me kangaroo. And then I'd say, oh, shut up. And he's a lot of fun.
Was he wild and outrageous in private, or a totally different Mick Jagger to the one that we know?
No, it's pretty normal in private. You know, he just wants a bit of peace and quiet and hang out and have a bit of fun and, you know, good sense of humour. You know, big ego, you know, the spa with you.
I'm being very cheeky
here, great.
Sue, because that's what I'm like. Did he want to add you to his, shall we say, lusty list of conquests?
Oh, well, I think Mick wants to add anyone to that list. But I did have this wonderful birthday party. It was really amazing at Eric. I was so overwhelmed. I was on my 20th birthday at St John's Wood, and he invited everybody, you know. So Mick Jagger came, bought me a gift, and George Harrison and the Pythons and the Oddies and all these really famous people. And we're just in jeans at home, and so Mick was there, and we were kind of chatting and stuff, and I think Eric got really jealous and for some reason thought that I wanted to be with Mick, which was completely wrong, because I'm just completely quite anti anyone who's vaguely a playboy. Does not interest me at all. It's like, that's like, whoop, off the list.
Always look on the bright side of life.
You could have become Mrs. Eric Idle.
Yes.
Did he propose?
Yes.
And you said no?
Yes.
Why?
I was just too young to get married. I mean, Eric was already married, so he was just getting divorced. He had a one-year-old son, and I was 19, and I just wasn't ready.
Sue did get married a few years later and had two sons, but it wasn't the happiest of marriages.
One day he abducted the children. We weren't getting on. A marriage guidance counsellor, he talked her into... She had a crush on him. He was a very good-looking man, by the way. And he said, oh, Randy wants to take the children to the States. And I said, well, no, I don't think so. Jesse can't bear to be apart from me for, like, more than 6 hours. And Randy's, you know, really doing great in Suzuki violin and his tennis lessons. Nah. So he left the country. I found out on a wedding anniversary he wasn't coming back after he'd been there for 6 weeks, and I couldn't find out where he was, and he wouldn't talk to me anymore or return my calls, and his parents wouldn't tell me where he was, and I started completely flipping out. It was terrible, and they were abducted. And then he kept them away from me for 6 months so he could say that they were residents of the United States. And all they were like, Mummy, Mummy, come and get us. And if I took them back, then I would be an abductress. This is what happened. And it was just absolutely horrific. And so I chased him around the country with private detectives and my father, and I had Mother Teresa's lawyer in New York helping me. And it was the most traumatic thing I could imagine anyone going through, because I just love my children, as we do, so much.
You must have spent so many nights in tears.
I still can't talk about it.
How did it get resolved?
Long, hard path. Long, hard path. Eventually they were 18 and they came back to Australia, and I flew them out every year. And they just absolutely love and adore me. Thank God, because he tried to completely act like the mother didn't exist and she was a bad woman, and he made up all sorts of lies. It was just, it was just shocking. I was a really good wife.
What was that first hug like when you got your boys back?
Oh, beyond crazy. You know, beyond crazy fabulous. Yeah. I just became a grandmother. Hey! That's a real head trip.
Can you believe you're a grandma?
No, but how fabulous. 2 months ago. And then I think, well, you know, I've got a couple of girlfriends who are like 36 and they're grandmas, so whatever. But no, it's a wonderful thing, and it is definitely a big deal.
Do you reckon you've still got it?
Yeah, totally, no problem. I probably have to do a few tweaks. I'm not talking about, I don't believe in all of that plastic surgery stuff. I'm just saying, you know, lose a little weight and, you know, step up.
Engaging and complex woman she is. Fascinating story there, yeah, by Craig Bennett. Delivering the, hitting the home runs as he always does when it comes to entertainment news.